We now come to the backbench business motion on the 25th anniversary of the Kurdish genocide. Nadhim Zahawi to move.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I stand, as you noticed, Mr. Deputy Speaker, not from my usual place in this House. I chose to sit next to the member for Harlow purposely today because I think in this Parliament no one has done more for the cause of the Kurdish people and the recognition of the genocide than the member of Harlow. Indeed, he chairs the Genocide Task Force in this House. Mr. Deputy Speaker, as the horrors of the Holocaust pass beyond living memory, there is a danger that we drop our guard, that we believe such terrible events are safely sealed in the history books, that they could never happen again. But the truth is, they've already happened again. Genocide did not end with the fall of the Third Reich in 1945. The Srebrenica genocide in 1995 saw 8,000 Bosnians murdered en masse. The Rwandan genocide in 1994 saw over 500,000 people killed in just 100 days. And between 1960 and 1991, the campaign of persecution unleashed by Saddam Hussein against his own people, singling out the Kurdish community, saw over 1 million people disappear, most presumed dead, murdered by government forces. Yet only the first two have been recognised officially as genocide. No international criminal tribunal has been convened to investigate the extermination of the Kurdish people. There has been no international campaign to bring those responsible for these atrocities to justice. The British government have not formally stated that the actions of Saddam and his lieutenants constituted genocide. That, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is something that must be put right. To many people, the plight of the Kurds in Iraq remains unknown. The demonisation, the internment camps, the gassings, the mass graves, these are images that take us to the darkest depths of the 1940s and not the 1980s. Yet Saddam Hussein and the Ba'athist regime carried out these actions. The Iraqi Kurds endured a systematic military programme of discrimination, demonisation, removal and death. So-called men of battle age, a definition that included tall, strong boys as young as 12, were rounded up and thousands of women and children vanished. Strong evidence shows many were taken to internment camps where they were executed or died from malnutrition and torture. When coalition forces entered Iraq looking for the weapons of mass destruction, they instead found mass graves and the thousands of bodies that they were concealing. Men, women and children, all killed for nothing other than their ethnicity, their bodies hidden from the eyes of the world. This year is the 25th anniversary of the final act in this persecution. The Anfal campaign, literally translated, it means the spoils of war. This last and best known phase took place in 1988 when over 182,000 Kurds are believed to have died. 182,000 people, Mr. Deputy Speaker, 182,000 men, women and children systematically wiped out. All in all, over 2,000 Kurdish villages and towns were destroyed, including the town of Qaladizah, which along with its 70,000 inhabitants was literally wiped off the map. Let me put this in context for you, sir. This is enough people to fill Wembley Stadium twice over. Or when compared to the horrors of September 11th, the attacks against the USA, it is 60 times the 3,000 innocents killed on that terrible, terrible day. Yet even that was not the worst of it. On March the 16th, 1988, Iraqi planes bombed the town of Halabja with mustard gas and some suspect other nerve agents such as sarin and VX. 5,000 civilians died in incredible agony that day, and estimates suggest a further 7,000 were injured or suffered long-term illness. For years afterwards, Many babies were born with deformities. And even today, if you visit Halabja, as I have done, you will see mass grave sites and the basements of bombed out buildings remain contaminated. For me, the events hold a personal significance, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I am proud to be the first British MP of Kurdish descent, and it was the persecution of the Kurdish people that brought my family to the safe haven of Great Britain. As an eight-year-old boy, I remember standing with my mother at Baghdad International Airport, watching my father attempt to flee that country, boarding a plane for the safe haven of Britain. The night before, he'd been tipped off that the regime was planning on coming for him. As the plane taxis towards the runway, we watched in horror as an army vehicle stopped the plane and the soldiers boarded it. It was only later that we discovered that they had taken the man sitting right next to him. That, Mr. Deputy Speaker, was the life of a Kurdish family in Iraq, waiting for the knock on the door in the middle of the night, knowing that they could be coming for you, living in fear. In 1988, as news of Halabja reached the Kurdish community overseas, we all waited for the media to take notice. In a box in my attic, I have some of the first photographs to get out of that region. They are, as you can imagine, Mr. Deputy Speaker, horrifying. Yet Saddam's spin machine had gone into overdrive. No gas had been used, they said, and the first Western journalist didn't visit the area until over a week later. What confronted them was truly terrible. Writing in The Guardian, David Hurst described the scene. This is what he said. The skin of the bodies is strangely discoloured, with their eyes open and staring, where they have not disappeared into their sockets, a greyish slime oozing from their mouths and their fingers still grotesquely twisted. Death seemingly caught them almost unawares, in the midst of their household chores. They had just the strength, some of them, to make it to the doorways of their homes, only to collapse there, or a few feet beyond. Here a mother seems to have clasped her children in a last embrace. There an old man shields an infant from he cannot have known what. Even after that, there was still scepticism from many. Yet this was just the culmination of a decade-long campaign against the Kurdish people, the final stage of the regime's attempt to wipe out the Kurdish people in Iraq. Saddam had unleashed all the resources of a modern industrialized state on the Kurdish population of his own country. His forces used chemical weapons, concentration camps, and aerial bombardment, all methods that were last seen during the Second World War. If it was not genocide, Mr. Deputy Speaker, then what, one has to ask, what would it be? Mr. Deputy Speaker, the crime of genocide was brought into law to prosecute those put on trial at Nuremberg. The word comes from the Greek for race and the Latin for killing. The literal meaning is clear, but legally it requires the aggressor to have pre-planned the destruction of a national group. In their investigation, Human Rights Watch are clear that this was the case, and they stated this. This crime far transcended legitimate counterinsurgency and includes the murder and disappearance of tens of thousands of non-combatants due to their ethnic national identity. The fact that some of these atrocities took place during the Iran-Iraq War or during a time of uprising have led some to argue that they were war crimes or crimes against humanity. But, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I disagree. There is no doubt there were atrocities committed in conflict. But what occurred in Kurdistan, the mass killings of civilians, women and children, was not a conflict. One side could not and did not fight back. Nor was it random violence. It was the planned destruction of the Kurdish population. Prior to asking for this debate, I launched an e-petition calling for the government to recognise formally the genocide against the people of Iraqi Kurdistan. As of this morning, it had nearly 28,000 signatures, and at 10,000 signatures, it received a response from the government. In their response, the government stated this: "It remains the government's view that it is not for the government to decide whether a genocide has been committed in this case, as this is a complex legal question. Where an international judicial body finds a crime to have been a genocide, however, this will often play an important part in whether we will recognise one as such. Yet without international pressure, it is unlikely that an international judicial body will begin a prosecution in order to provide that important part that the government requires. Then there is also the fact that many of those responsible, including Saddam himself, were tried and executed for other crimes before an international court could intervene on the question of genocide. However, in March 2010, the Iraqi Supreme Court ruled that the operations of 1988 were genocide. This was 4 years after Saddam was executed for crimes against humanity. But there is no doubt now that he should also have stood trial for genocide as well. I will.
And I apologise for being a couple of minutes late for the start of his speech, which caught me out. I think the case he's making is very strong. Isn't it also the fact that some other countries' parliaments have already said, in their opinion, Norway being one, that there was a genocide, and therefore the defence, the position that the British government is taking, needs to be reconsidered?
I thank my honourable friend for that intervention. He's absolutely right, and I'm coming to that in my speech. It's not just Norway. There are other countries as well, as he cites. Iraqi Supreme Court ruled the operation as genocide. And earlier this year, the Norwegian government, as we've just heard, recognised the Anfal campaign as genocide, stating that the judgment in Iraq, in accordance with international law, justified this decision. Sweden then followed with the Swedish Parliament stating that, based on research, statements from organisations, and the 2010 judgment in Iraq, was legally able to make this declaration. In the Netherlands, we have even seen a Dutch citizen successfully prosecuted for his part in this genocide. Frans van Anraat was tried at The Hague and charged, amongst other things, with selling chemicals, knowing they were going to be used for genocidal purposes. Such a charge required the court to decide whether or not the Anfal campaign was indeed genocide. Unsurprisingly, they agreed it was. So there exists a judicial decision in Iraq, a decision at The Hague, and the decisions of other nations stating their support for the genocide that was committed against the Kurds. So the United Kingdom can act and make it clear to the world that this government recognises the genocide committed against the Kurdish people. Mr. Deputy Speaker, but beyond the legal arguments, there is another important dimension. Around the world, the United Kingdom carries enormous moral weight. I am proud that Britain is at the forefront of the international community when it comes to protecting human rights and standing up to regimes that threaten their people and their neighbours. That is why we must be at the forefront of this argument. Certainly.
Can I congratulate the Honourable Gentleman and stand shoulder to shoulder with him with his desire to see this recognised as a genocide? But in relation to the point he's just making, with almost 38 million Kurdish people across Syria, Iran, Iraq and Turkey, does he also think that this bolsters the position of Kurdish people today? And in fact, does he also believe, with tremendous concern at the position of Kurdish people in Turkey at the moment, that it is important that we recognise these past sins?
I thank the Honourable Gentleman for his intervention. I think he's quite right. I don't think the Kurdish people can get closure on the dreadful, horrific crimes that were committed against them in Iraq. And this will go one step if this Parliament today recognises what took place as genocide, and will send a clear message to all those countries who may at some point be tempted to attack their own people for their ethnicity, to certainly think twice about that. So I thank him for being here and supporting this motion.
Jeremy Clark,
I give way. Giving my
way, and I congratulate him on getting the debate and his speech today, which I think will do a great deal to create greater understanding of the plight of Kurdish people in all countries. Would he ever, however, reflect for one moment that whilst what happened in 1988 was genocide and was appalling, this country, to its shame, continued selling arms to Iraq and indeed took part in the Baghdad arms fair less than a year later and continued supplying weaponry to Iraq which could and may well have been used against the Kurdish people in their continuing oppression?
Well, as I said earlier in my opening remarks, and I thank him for his intervention, that the Saddam Hussein spin machine, all the instruments of power that were available to him, including a number of people who lobbied very hard, this parliament and the government of the time, to continue to do business with Saddam. But I have to, at this point, then recognise John Major in his contribution to safeguarding the Kurds in 91 when Saddam uses helicopter gunships to attack the Kurdish people post the Iraq invasion of Kuwait, where this government and this country decided to place a no-fly zone to protect the Kurdish people as well as the people of the south of Iraq, the Shias of Iraq, who were coming under that similar attack. I will give way.
I congratulate the Honourable Gentleman in getting the debate today, but does he not see what he said today and what he's asking for as a step for justice for the Kurdish people across the Middle East? Because various countries of the Middle East have been mentioned, for example, Turkey. So the way I see it, the Honourable Gentleman's done quite a service today if it starts to use an expression, the ball rolling for justice for the Kurdish people across the Middle East, but in particular Turkey.
I thank the Honourable Gentleman for his intervention. I think that if we can send a clear message today that we recognise what took place in Iraq as genocide against the Kurdish people, it will send a clear message, as I, in my response earlier, said to all those leaders of those countries in the region that they cannot, or they certainly should think twice before they decide to attack their own people, as we're seeing currently in Syria. Indeed, we know that today there's a conference in Rome where the Foreign Secretary is taking part to try and see what more we can do to safeguard the welfare of the Syrian people. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I would just returning to my earlier remarks, I am truly proud that Britain is at the forefront of the international community when it comes to protecting human rights. So recognising the Kurdish persecution as genocide will send a strong message to those totalitarian regimes around the world who may consider committing such acts. After all, history has shown us that when a dictator thinks they will get away with it, they will commit atrocities against their own people. We need only turn our gaze to Syria to remind ourselves of that. It is only by raising international awareness of these crimes that we will educate people against the intolerance and hatred that led to these heinous acts. It is only by providing the perpetrators of these crimes, by proving that the perpetrators of these crimes can and will be brought to justice, that we will make the dictators of this world think before they act. It is through the recognition of the Kurdish genocide that we can ensure these aims and that the British nation can cement its position as a protector of liberty and human rights. I commend this motion to the House.
The question is, as on the order paper, Meg Munn.
Indeed, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I refer to my entries in the Register of Members' Interests. It is an honour to speak in this important debate. Over the last 5 years, I have been involved with the Kurdistan Region of Iraq All-Party Parliamentary Group, which I am now proud to co-chair with my honourable friend, the Member for Stratford-on-Avon, who has eloquently set out the reason for this debate. I should mention, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that the All-Party Group is very active and has an excellent website with a range of views and news, and members can look at the issues around Kurdistan and look at the issues relating to this debate on that website at www.appgkurdistan.org.uk. Genocide, as my honourable friend has said, is the methodical killing of all the people from a particular national, ethnic or religious group. Today's debate is an important milestone towards persuading this House, the wider public and the international community to recognise the attempted genocide in Iraq of the Kurdish people by Saddam Hussein. As my honourable friend for Stratford has already said, an estimated 1 million Iraqis have disappeared since the 1960s, all presumed murdered by the regime. And as this year marks the 25th anniversary of the Anfal genocide operation against the Kurds, including the dreadful chemical attack on Halabja, as well as the 30th anniversary of the killing of 8,000 male members of the Barzani clan, the scale of these atrocities is clear and not seriously challenged. But few outside of the Kurdistan region understand what was involved in the mass slaughter, and fewer still understand the organisation and methods used in what has been described as Saddam's killing machine. It has been referred to as a prison above ground and a mass grave beneath. The targeting of the Kurdish people living in northern Iraq was designed to remove any possibility of opposition to the vile regime. Last night I watched again two DVDs which have been produced by the Iraqi Ministry of Human Rights about the terrible crimes committed by Saddam Hussein's regime, execution of people and dust talks. They include pictures of some of the atrocities filmed by the regime. Shootings and beatings, the severing of ears of young men who had deserted the army. They show the devastation of the way of life of the marsh Arabs by the deliberate draining of the marshes and, of course, the chemical attacks at Halabja and elsewhere. Today, we only have words to try and describe what happened, and I fear they will fall short of portraying the full horror. These monstrous events have a contemporary relevance. Many families still do not know if a father, brother, sister is dead or not, do not know where their body may be buried, perhaps in some undiscovered mass grave. Not knowing about the fate of a member of the family weighs heavy. The impact of the killing continues and will continue for many, many years to come. It's important to remember just how closed and controlled a society Iraq was. There were few opportunities for contact with the outside world. After the no-fly zone was imposed over Kurdistan in 1991, the people had at last the opportunity to begin to develop their own democracy, to make their own decisions. But sustained contact with the outside world only really began after the 2003 invasion. And it was only then that we slowly began to understand the true scale of the horror. According to the International Commission on Missing Persons, in 2006, there were 270 mass graves, each estimated to contain between 10 bodies to 10,000 bodies. Since then, there have been many, many more mass graves uncovered. Of course, it was not just the Kurds who suffered under Saddam Hussein. The impact of 35 years of dictatorship are still very evident in all sections of the Iraqi population. I have visited Iraq a number of times and have been privileged to meet the politicians who are building their democracy. Some have shared with me their experiences of that dark time. Family members killed, tortured, or simply missing. I know that the number of widows in the country is simply huge. In Kurdistan today, many children are affected with cancers caused by the chemical weapons. Others live with the effects of barbaric torture. 10 years after the fall of the dictator, the health services are far from adequate to meet the needs of this population. But they are improving. In the UK, we've benefited from the Iraqi doctors who came to work here during the time of exile. And it is encouraging to see that many have returned and are now working to improve health services in their home country. Indeed, it was an Iraqi doctor in Sheffield who began the process which has led to significant partnerships between Sheffield Hallam University and the Iraqi Ministry of Health and Iraqi universities to provide much-needed skills for the health service. And a strong partnership has also developed with the Kurdistan Regional Government. alongside the physical impact.
Can I thank my humble friend for giving way? Can I also raise the great support that's been given by the members of the Newcastle Gateshead Medical Volunteers, led by Deary Carey, who, as well as the people from Sheffield, have been going across to Kurdistan for a number of years now, and next month it will be the 8th time they've gone across, and they are treating people every day when they're there. Thousands and thousands of people have benefited from the relationship we've developed between our two countries.
I thank my honourable friend for bringing that partnership to the attention of the House. It is very true that there are many, many doctors in the UK of Iraqi and Iraqi Kurdish origin. And while they've continued to serve and provide support for our community, they also are doing such things as he has described and are doing what they can at a time when the health services in Iraq still need a great deal of investment to develop to serve an ordinary population, let alone a population that has suffered the kind of trauma and torture and chemical attacks that have been suffered in Iraq and particularly in Kurdistan. Alongside the physical impact of repression on the population, we must not underestimate the psychological effects. Living with the grief of lost family members, remembering the terror of attacks, and above all, the constant fear. And as a woman says in the DVD I mentioned earlier, Iraqi people had no dignity because they had to sell out their consciences to Saddam Hussein to stay alive. 35 years of dictatorship is not easily forgotten, but there are positive moments since the 2003 invasion. We remember the TV pictures of the purple-stained fingers shown with pride when they were able to exercise the right to vote, something we take for granted. The Iraqi people were excited about being able to take part in the first democratic elections, but voting is, of course, only the first act. Building the institutions and democratic habits are much more difficult. All the more difficult when you have not been allowed to make your own decisions and acting on your own initiative was a risky thing to do. My involvement with the Kurdistan Regional and Iraqi National Parliaments has shown me just how difficult this task is. But it is a task to which many brave Iraqis are committed. To take on these tasks and build a new society is complex and demanding. It will take time, dedication and determination. We should continue to support them in this. An important way to do that is to formally recognise what happened to them. Former French Foreign Minister Bernard Kouchner argues that human rights should mean that people are protected within their own countries. When these rights are violated, it is the duty of the international community to honour victims and to ensure history cannot repeat itself. If democratic governments cannot be clear about genocide and say that such crimes must be stamped out, then who will?
You're very well at this point. Thank you for giving way and very interesting points she's making. Does she also accept that there is a fairly systematic discrimination against Kurdish people, culture and language in all the neighbouring countries as well? And this is a product of the breakup of the Ottoman and the end of the First World War, and that all those countries have got to reckon with a multicultural, multilingual, multi-ethnic society if there's to be a long-term peace within the region.
Building the kind of society he describes, which recognises the rights of people to their own language, their own culture, and to celebrate their own background, is enormously important, and it is very much part of this process. And while the process of building the democracies in Iraq and working with Iraqi parliamentarians are difficult, what is encouraging is to see Iraqis across all political groups and backgrounds working together. Next week we will have the Services and Reconstruction Committee from the Iraqi Parliament visiting us here, which is actually chaired by a Kurdish Yazidi woman. They will be coming here and they will contain people from all backgrounds and with all differences together, working together to try and build things for the Iraqi people. So I agree with much of what the Honourable Gentleman says.
She mentions very eloquently the position in France and the position of the French Foreign Minister, does she recall that just a few weeks ago three Kurdish women were shot dead in Paris? And it does convey the continued concern that we should all have about Kurdish people as they go about their business in Europe, and illustrates the point that's been made about why we must recognise genocide, but why we must also recognise that these are a people that continue to be routinely oppressed.
My right honourable friend is right, and I have particular concerns as well about the position of Kurdish people and other people indeed. There are currently over 70,000 dead in Syria, and with the ever-present fear of chemical weapons being used by that regime, a frightening reminder of the Halabja poison gas attack. Some of those effects, as we've already mentioned, of the 16th of March 1988 attack on Halabja are with us still. Disease, birth defects and other health complications. Can we easily accept the possibility that more victims of these weapons could arise today in Iraq's neighbouring country? We know of the genocide perpetrated against the Jews by the Nazis during the Second World War and the excellent work undertaken by organisations such as the Holocaust Educational Trust to educate new generations about the horror. Every year we have Holocaust Memorial Day to honour the dead and ensure they are not forgotten. The story of the Kurdish genocide has yet to be fully told and is not yet fully understood. But the Kurdish people should not have to wait for justice from the international community any longer. Iraq has officially recognised the killings of genocide, and the rest of the world must do the same.
Robert Halfen.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and it is an honour to sit next to my honourable friend, the Member for Stratford, and I congratulate him for this debate today and for everything he has done on the All-Party Kurdistan Group, and I have been very proud to work with him on it. Now, in my last visit to Kurdistan, I remember being one evening in a restaurant, and I was sitting by chance next to the one of the senior people of the Iraqi War Graves Commission. And she said to me something incredibly telling and really sums up why I'm here this afternoon. She said, "There is another Iraq buried under Iraq." And we had a big, huge amount of food, as is the Kurdish way, in front of us. And I literally, after she said that, I felt that I couldn't eat again that evening. Because to me it summed up the mass murder and the terrible crimes of Saddam Hussein. And later, with my honourable friend for Basildon and others, we went to see some of these graves. And it has left a marked impression on me since, and sums up why we have to recognise Saddam Hussein's genocide of the Kurds as exactly that. Now, we know that the actions of the Iraqi regime from the 1960s to 2003 were a sustained campaign of genocide against the Kurdish people. We mustn't make the mistake of just thinking everything started in 1988 with the Anfal. And second, that if it wasn't for muscular enlightenment and the military intervention, first from John Major and later from Tony Blair, that this final solution of the extermination of the Kurds would have been successful. And thirdly, recognition for the genocide, for the Kurds, is important, not just because it is morally right, but it is a warning to tyrants around the world, and it helps the survivors fight for justice in the International Criminal Courts. And let me explain what I mean. Raphael Lemkin, the Polish lawyer who coined the word genocide, defined it in 1944, and I quote, "as a coordinated plan of different actions aiming at the destruction of essential foundations of the life of national groups with the aim of annihilating the groups themselves." That is a perfect description of the campaign of persecution and murder which Saddam Hussein and his predecessors led against the Kurdish people. And the Kurds were repeatedly attacked by the Iraqi military from 1960 to 1970. In March 1970, Iraq publicly announced a peace plan to the world for Kurdish autonomy, but privately they started an aggressive Arabization program in the oil-rich regions of Kurdistan, forcibly removing people and seizing their property. In 1974, Iraq then began a new bombardment against the Kurds. In March 1975, Iraq and Iran signed the Algiers Accord, cutting humanitarian supplies to Kurdistan. And over the next 3 years, 200,000 Kurds were forcibly deported to other parts of Iraq. During the Iran-Iraq War in the 1980s, the regime implemented anti-Kurdish policies, pogroms in essence, and a civil war broke out. Iraq was condemned but was never seriously punished. The result was that the genocide accelerated. First the Kurds were demonised, then they were marginalised, then they were persecuted, and finally they were massacred. All the stages of genocide. Between 1986 and 1989, the Anfal campaign led to the destruction of over 2,000 villages and towns and the murder of more than 180,000 Kurdish civilians. That was the cold-blooded use of ground offences, internment without trial, disappearances, aerial bombing, torture and rape as a weapon of war, destruction of whole villages and towns, mass deportations, firing squads, and chemical attacks, including the inhuman attack on the Kurdish town, as so movingly described by my honourable friend for Stratford of Halabja in 1988, that killed 5,000 people almost instantly. And we shouldn't forget that when, just before Saddam Hussein dropped the mustard gas, they dropped bombs to blow up the windows of the houses so none of the Kurds could actually escape inside the buildings and retreat from the mustard gas. Now, after the collapse of the Kurdish uprising in March 1991, 1.5 million Kurds became refugees. And it was only then, after decades of escalating violence and genocide, that in April 1991, the United Nations Security Council passed Resolution 688, demanding peace in Kurdistan and access for humanitarian agencies. And disgracefully, this was the first international resolution, the first to mention the Kurdish people by name. In 2004, Human Rights Watch said, in the last 25 years of the Ba'ath Party rule, the Iraqi government murdered or disappeared some 250,000 Iraqis, if not more. And as with every other genocide, the methods of killing became ever more sophisticated. Think shooting in the woods by the Nazis and then the concentration camps. And my honourable friend for Basildon will remember going to a prison called the Red Room, which was in essence a mini concentration camp, where there were rooms called the party rooms, where women were raped. Their babies and their fetuses were literally thrown into ovens outside. Now, I've never seen anything like that in my life, and I never want to see it again. In fact, on my second visit, I stayed outside what is called the Red Room because I did not want to go inside and see what I had seen. Saddam and the Ba'athists were determined to vacuum the Kurds from Iraq, partly because of Arab nationalism and partly a desire to gain full control over Kurdish lands and oil. And if you define genocide as scientifically planned mass murder, then the Kurds suffer genocide. Now, I know that there is always a debate about definitions, but the Anfal campaign was a murder of 182,000 people and the displacement of 1.5 million just because they were Kurdish. How is this any different, for example, from the 1995 massacres of 8,000 Muslims at Srebrenica, which has been ruled to be a genocide by the International Criminal Court? How is it different from Rwanda, where 800,000 Tutsis died in 1994, which the UN rightly recognises as a genocide? How is it different from Darfur, where the International Criminal Court in 2010 issued an arrest warrant for the president of Sudan on genocide charges after 300,000 people were murdered and millions were displaced? Yugoslavia, Rwanda are recognised formally by the United Nations as having had genocides. The US Secretary of State Colin Powell said that the massacres in Darfur were a genocide. And since that time, however, no other permanent member of the UN security has followed suit. Now, I accept that the minister will feel hemmed in by the definitions. But to the man in the street, how are the scientific murders of Darfur, of Rwanda, or what happened in the former Yugoslavia any different from what happened in Kurdistan? In 1948, the United General Assembly adopted the Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide, and it legally defined the crime of genocide as, and I quote, any of the following acts committed with intent to destroy, in whole or in part, a national, ethnical, racial or religious group, as such, killing members of a group, B, causing serious bodily or mental harm to members of the group, C, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring out its physical destruction, D, imposing measures intended to prevent births within the group, E, or forcibly transferring children of the group to another group. Now that is plain and clear in that convention. And that is exactly what has happened to the Kurds in Iraq over the last 50 years. It's worth remembering too, as my honourable friend noted, that in December 2005, a court in The Hague ruled that the Kurdish people had faced genocide in the 1980s. Now, my next point is that what stopped the genocide was actually NATO intervention, what I have termed muscular enlightenment. In April 1991, John Major and his Western allies established proper safe havens inside Iraqi borders and a no-fly zone. And it's good to see Lord Archer, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in these parts, yeah, who was so instrumental to making that happen. Kurdish guerrillas recaptured Erbil and founded the Kurdistan Regional Government, which was ultimately recognised by the new Iraqi constitution in 2005. By the beginning of 2006, the two Kurdish administrations of Erbil and Sulaymaniyah were unified. It is now one of the most moderate and democratic regions of the entire Middle East. And it disproves those who say that the Middle East is not ready for democracy. People always say they're just not ready yet. It won't happen for a long time. It's going to take hundreds of years to build. But the Kurdistan people, despite what they have suffered, have built a democracy, not perfect, but a good democracy with the rule of law, property rights, equality towards women, religious tolerance, and elections, all the requirements that we understand as being the values of freedom. And it is no accident that Christians across the rest of Iraq, where do they go when they are being persecuted? They go to Kurdistan because they know that they will be treated fairly and equally, yeah, as is right. Now, finally, we must recognise Saddam Hussein's actions for what they were. Recognition is morally right. It acts as a warning to other dictators around the world, and it will help Kurds to fight for justice in the International Criminal Court. Unlike Nazi Germany, where many of those responsible for the Holocaust were tried, there has little justice happened to those who actually caused the Kurdish genocide. It is a frightening thought, but it is said that some of the organisers of the Anfal and the pilots who dropped the chemical weapons remain at large and may even be in Europe, and others are in positions of responsibility in Iraq's military and government. To be fair, Iraq has now officially recognised the genocide, and it must be the duty of the rest of the world to do the same, to ensure that all the perpetrators are brought to the ICC and to help with education and remembrance so that we ensure that what happened is never forgotten by the future generations. Now, we can all have arguments about dodgy dossiers. We can disagree about United Nations resolutions. We will be debating, I'm sure, till the next millennium as to whether the Iraq war was justified. But one matter that is indisputable is that the removal of Saddam Hussein not only saved the Kurdish nation from being destroyed by genocide, but also has brought about an independent, progressive, free nation in the shape of Kurdistan. Now, I am a Jewish MP. I have very few Kurdish people in my constituency. And so, because I am Jewish, and because I am steeped in learning about the Holocaust, and because some of my family were in Bergen-Belsen, I have come to this place believing it is my moral duty to try and help other nations that have suffered from genocide. And one of the worst quotations one ever hears is never again. And we always talk about never again, and you never imagine that what happened in the Second World War could happen only 25 years ago. But you had it all over again, and the mustard gas reminds me of it all too clear. And if we are to make never again more than just a slogan, we have to really mean it. And we have to ensure that the Kurdish genocide is recognised as one of the world's greatest crimes. And that is why, as I said at the beginning of this debate, I'm very proud to be here today, because this is a historic moment for our parliament that has such close relations with Kurdistan, and that I hope very much will support the motion to recognise the genocide and the evil crimes of Saddam Hussein.
Yeah. And cleared.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I congratulate the Honourable Member opposite for securing this debate. I think it's a very important one, and of course it has particular significance around this time. For years here in the House of Commons, I have chaired meetings in the Grand Committee Room where we've commemorated Halabja year after year after year. And indeed in 1988, along with some other members, cross-party, I took a group of women to a hospital in London where some of the survivors of the Halabja incident were actually recovering. They were women who had been badly burned from the use of the chemicals, and some of them could not speak because the effect of the chemical weapons had actually harmed their windpipes. I hope those people survived. And I was glad that at least some of them had the opportunity to be brought to London for that treatment. And in 1988-89, my honourable friend for Islington, who was here earlier, attempted to protest at the Iraqi embassy about the use of chemical weapons against the Kurds. And, of course, the ambassador at that time told us if he knew nothing about it. It was all a mystery to him. And he said, would you like to come and visit Baghdad? And we said, no, well, we'd actually like to go and visit Kurdistan, where the chemical weapons attack has taken place. And he continued to say, I don't know anything about it, but I will get in touch with Baghdad and see what we can do. Well, he played a cat and mouse game with us for several months, period of 6 months. At the end of it, I sent a letter to the Financial Times saying this was obviously just a game. It wasn't a game for us as politicians who had followed the Kurds for many years. We actually protested here in this house in 1988, 89 and throughout. And I first became involved with the Kurds as early as 1977, before I was a politician, when many of them were in Cardiff at the university as students, One of them, of course, but later, was Bahram Saleh. And many prominent Kurds were present at the university. And there were also Iraqi students. And they all told us about what was actually happening in Iraq. It was very difficult to get an accurate picture at that time. And it wasn't until the chemical weapons attack, really, that the West, the public in the West, were made very aware of the kind of weapons Saddam Hussein was prepared to use against his own people. And, of course, the charge of genocide was proved in the tribunal in Iraq, where many prominent Iraqis and Iraqis mainly were tried, and Ali Hassan al-Majid, of course, who subsequently was sentenced to death and was known as Chemical Ali, and the charge of genocide was made against him, and the charge of genocide was proved against Ali Hassan al-Majid. Now, those of us who campaigned over a long period of time, I chaired the campaign against repression for democratic rights in Iraq, Qadri, which many people, Kurds and Iraqis living in London, were actually members of at the time. And one of the things that we did constantly was publish the records of what was happening to the Kurds, to the Iraqis, what was going on in the prisons. We had actually very good accounts, they were horrific accounts, of the kind of torture that was being used against the people of Kurdistan and the people of Iraq. And some of the tortures, of course, were horrific. And later when I actually opened the Genocide Museum in Kurdistan when it was first opened, and I remember relatives of those who had been killed during the Anfal campaign coming to me. It was a very memorable day. It was snowing, it was grey, and to go into that museum of torture to see where so many Kurds had perished at the time left a lasting impression on all of us. And women were coming towards me with photographs of their relatives who had died, wrapped in cling film, and they were elderly women, and they were pushing these photographs and showing me which of their relatives had died in that torture centre in Sulaymaniyya. Of course, Qadri collected a lot of evidence. We had photographs, we had witness statements, and when Indict was set up a few years later, Indict also for 7 years collected evidence of Iraqi war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide. And that, of course, that evidence was used, I'm glad to say, in the trials which subsequently took place in Baghdad. Now, many of us knew or thought we knew what was going on in Iraq. Of course, wasn't fully explained until really after 2003. But I first went to Kurdistan in 1991, and I went back there, I suppose, every 2 or 3 years after that. And, you know, there were constant stories of disappearances, of sightings of people in prisons, and nobody quite knew where many of their loved ones had gone. But we know that the Anfal campaign was horrific. Now, I look back at a Human Rights Watch report, which was published in July 1993, and it's headed Genocide in Iraq, the Anfal campaign against the Kurds. And it says that allegations about enormous abuses against the Kurds by government security forces had been circulating in the West for years before the events of 1991. Kurdish rebels had spoken of 4,000 destroyed villages and an estimated 182,000 disappeared persons during 1988 alone. the Anfal, the official military code name used by the government in its public pronouncements and internal memoranda, was well known inside Iraq, especially in the Kurdish region. As all the horrific details have emerged, remember this was written in 1993, this name has seared itself into popular consciousness, much as the Nazi German Holocaust did with its survivors. The parallels are apt and often chillingly close. In February 1990, Human Rights in Iraq, Middle East Watch, reconstructed what took place from exiled sources, with what in retrospect turned out to be a high degree of accuracy. Even so, some of the larger claims made by the Kurds seemed too fantastic to credit. As it transpires, this has been a humbling learning process for all those foreigners who followed Kurdish affairs from abroad. Western reporters, relief workers, human rights organisations and other visitors to Iraqi Kurdistan have come to realise that the overall scale of the suffering inflicted on the Kurds by their own government was by no means exaggerated. And now, Middle East Watch went on to say that it can now demonstrate convincingly a deliberate intent on the part of the government of Saddam Hussein to destroy, through mass murder, part of Iraq's Kurdish minority. Two government instruments, the government's 1987 National Census and the Declaration of Prohibited Areas, were institutional foundations of this policy. These instruments were implemented against the background of nearly two decades of government-directed Arabization, in which mixed-race districts, or else lands that Baghdad described as desirable or strategically important, saw the Kurdish population, diluted by Arab migrant farmers, provided with ample incentives to relocate and guarded by government troops. The logic of the Anfal, however, can't be divorced either from the Iran-Iraq war, because after 1986, both the PUK, Patriotic Union of Kurdistan, and the KDP, the Kurdistan Democratic Party, the two major parties, received support from the Iranian government and sometimes took part in joint military raids against Iraqi government positions. And it goes on to describe the link. Now, that, of course, doesn't make any difference to what Saddam Hussein did to his own people. While many will be familiar with the attacks on Halabja in March 1988, the incidents caused a brief international ripple. They may be surprised to learn that the first use of poison gas against the Kurds by central government occurred 11 months earlier. All told, Middle East Watch recorded 40 separate attacks on Kurdish targets, some of them involving multiple sorties over several days between 1987 and August 1988. Each of these attacks were war crimes involving the use of a banned weapon. The fact that non-combatants were often the victims added to the offence. In Anfal, at least 50,000 and possibly 100,000 people, many of them women and children, were killed out of hand between February and September 1988. And their deaths didn't come in the heat of battle. These Kurds were systematically put to death in large numbers on the orders of the central government in Baghdad. Days, sometimes weeks, after being rounded up in villages marked for destruction, or else while fleeing from army assaults in prohibited areas. Two experienced researchers from Human Rights Watch spent 6 months in northern Iraq between April and September 1992, gathering testaments about the Anfal. Previously, one 12-year-old boy had been the only known survivor of many accounts. The Kurds, men, women and children had been trucked southward to the Arab heartland of Iraq in large numbers and then disappeared. It was assumed they'd all been summarily executed, but there was no proof at that time. But anybody who subsequently has stood, as one of the honourable gentlemen opposite mentioned, by the side of a mass grave, and I've had to stand at the side of many mass graves in Iraq, seeing the bodies being excavated. And I remember one particular occasion when I was in Kurdistan, when what was assumed to be the mass grave of Peshmergas was being excavated. And around stood relatives of the Peshmerga who they thought had been placed in that grave. And slowly the skeletons were brought out. And there was one old man standing by me, and he recognised his son, who was one of the Peshmerga, and he recognised him only from the wedding ring on his hand, because he had got married a couple of weeks before. And that's how his father recognised the body of his son. And many of us who've seen mass graves elsewhere in Iraq and Kurdistan will know what a terrible occasion it is when family are standing around waiting to identify a piece of cloth, a ring, a piece of jewellery, a piece of clothing, and those who they couldn't identify, they were put back. I was in Al-Hilla seeing the excavation there because a team of British forensic scientists was helping on that occasion, and they found babies still held in the arms of their mothers or their fathers. But when they couldn't identify the body, they would put the remains back in a plastic bag and tie it up and put it on the top of a grave. And then people would walk round the graves, looking inside the bags, looking to see if they recognised anybody. And that, I think, is an appalling way to have to identify the body of a dead relative. But that is still going on, of course, in Iraq and in Kurdistan, because as somebody once said to me, Iraq is one mass grave. And I'm afraid I would like to see that work continue, because I think it's important that people do have some kind of closure. At least they know that somebody died there, was buried there, was shot there, or whatever. But a lot of people still don't know. And when you saw people queuing outside the Free Prisoners Association, you know, in queues down the streets, just trying to get in to find if they've got any information on a missing person, there are still a lot of people in Kurdistan and in Iraq as a whole who are very much in grief because they haven't had closure on the death of their relative. Mr. Deputy Speaker, based on the evidence we now have, Middle East Watch and others, many organisations, urges the international community to recognise that genocide occurred in Kurdistan during 1988. And the legal obligations to act on the basis of this information, to punish its perpetrators and prevent its recurrence, are of course undeniable. As I said at the beginning, there were many people who came to Kadri and told us what had happened to their relatives. In the 1980s, an Iraqi mother told us about her son, who was typical of so many thousands of people who have died in Iraq. He was a medical student who went out one day and never returned. Many months later, she was told to go to the mortuary and collect his body. She was led to the room where his body was to be found, and she said, quote, "When I entered and saw what was inside, I could not believe that there are people who could do such things to other human beings. I looked around and saw 9 bodies. My son was in a chair. He had blood all over him. His body was eaten away and bleeding. I looked at the others stretched out on the floor, all burnt. One of them had his chest slit with a knife. Another's body carried the marks of a hot domestic iron all over his head to his feet. Everyone was burnt in a different way. Another one had his legs cut off with an axe. His arms were also axed. One of them had his eyes gouged out and his nose and ears cut off. There were so many of these chilling accounts that at times over the years I found it difficult to believe. But now the horrors of Saddam's Iraq will continue to shock and astound the world. I have to say that in 1989, Saddam Hussein was still considered as a valued friend by this country. People still sent, the government of the day, sent trade missions to Baghdad. And as my honourable friend for Islington knows, we were invited to a cultural festival in Baghdad. And we protested time after time after time in this chamber about the fact that our trade links were still in place. And we were calling for sanctions against Iraq. So the history... Yes, certainly.
I thank my friend for giving away that point, and she raised the issue many times in the 1980s. Does she recall a delegation that she and I took part in to both the Foreign Office and the Department of Trade suggesting we should not take part in the Baghdad Arms Fair in 1989 and we should suspend all arms trades with Iraq at that time, and we were rebuffed by the ministers on that occasion?
Yes, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I remember that very well. It wasn't the only occasion on which we were rebuffed on these issues. Because we continued the campaign, and many others did, who long gone from this House. But now I think we should recognise that though Saddam Hussein was executed in relation to a previous trial, the rest of the co-defendants were charged with genocide, war crimes and crimes against humanity in relation to the Anfal campaign. Saddam Hussein, of course, Ali Hassan al-Majid, as I said earlier, was convicted of war crimes, crimes against humanity and genocide in relation to the Anfal campaign and sentenced to death. However, he was not executed until 2010. And a number of others, of course, were sentenced to death, but not on charges of genocide. So I think the case has been very well made over a long period of time, and I'm very happy to support this motion and the words of the people who put it forward, because the Kurds need recognition, and we and others are in a position to recognise genocide.
Metcalf.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I would like to draw the House's attention to my entry in the Register of Members' Interests. I remember the 16th of March as if it was yesterday. I remember the roar of military aircraft overhead, hiding in my family's shelter with my family and friends, and emerging hours later to find twisted, deformed bodies lying in the street. I remember people crushed under buildings and crying for help. And I remember the black smoke from the napalm bombs which billowed into the sky. These are the words of an Iraqi Kurdish journalist who, like other survivors of the Halabja poison gas massacre, will be haunted by the memories of March the 16th, 1988, for the rest of their lives. To ease their burden, we have to recognise their burden for what it is. And that is why we are here today. And that is why I want to thank my honourable friends, for Harlow, for his work on highlighting the wider issue of genocide, and to my friend from Stratford-on-Avon for his courage and his dedication to this issue. It is an important debate, and now more than ever is the time for recognition. As we approach the 25th anniversary of the events of the 16th and 17th of March 1988, now is the time to relook at recognition. Some 5,000 innocent people were brutally murdered, as we have heard, in the most abhorrent of circumstances. For the first time in history, a government used chemical weapons against its own people. As mustard gas and nerve agents rained down, the Kurdish people could do nothing but succumb to the brutal agony that these chemical weapons induce. As we have heard, this is but a snapshot of the Anfal genocide inflicted on the Kurdish people by Saddam Hussein and Chemical Ali between 1987 and 89. I say genocide because I truly believe that's what it was. As I understand it, and as we have heard explained, genocide can be defined in many ways as the gravest crime against humanity that is possible to commit. It is the mass extermination of a particular group of people in an attempt to wipe them off the face of the earth. In his own words, Saddam Hussein commissioned his cousin to solve the Kurdish problem and slaughter the saboteurs. In doing so, he initiated a two-year genocidal campaign characterized by mass summary executions, the disappearance of many tens of thousands of non-combatants, the destruction of some 2,000 villages, and the death of tens of thousands of women, children, and elderly people held without judicial order in jail. We must, as a parliament and as a nation, recognize these atrocities for what they were: genocide. Now, I'm a member of the All-Party Parliamentary Group on Kurdistan, and as such, have had the privilege of visiting the region last year. And before I continue on the topic of this debate, I just want first to pay homage to Kurdistan, many of whom are following this debate here today, for the great strides they have taken since the genocide. On the same day that I saw for myself one of the many mass graves that scar the land, I also saw a nation earnestly seeking to move forward. There is so much to be positive about in Kurdistan, and it presents some exciting opportunities for British business. The Kurdistan region today is enjoying an unprecedented era of economic growth and in an ever-improving security situation. After decades of destruction, neglect and isolation, they are beginning to develop their economy, to let free trade prosper and to promote commerce and investment. But as part of that process of looking forward, we have to help the Kurds come to terms with their past and deal with the full extent of what happened. I remember during my visit to Kurdistan hearing again and again about the atrocities, seeing firsthand the visible signs of a nation bearing a great burden, and visiting the memorial museum that my honourable friend Pahalo talked about, that now is housed in a former torture centre, where many of the worst crimes were committed. As an all-party parliamentary group and as a country, we are working to develop our relationship with the region, to maintain the already strong ties that we have in many areas and to nurture underdeveloped ties in others. Given Kurdistan's largest diaspora, who are watching today, these ties are extremely important and will only become increasingly so. Kurdistan is our ally and our friend, and it is therefore our duty to acknowledge this and to recognise the true extent of the atrocities that befell their people. The Kurdistan Regional Government, the KRG, are calling for Iraq to join the International Criminal Court as a way of preventing genocide happening again, and they have asked us to join them in their call for justice. And we, I believe, have a moral responsibility to respond to that call. Not to affirm the status of victim on the Kurdish people, but to recognise what they have survived and to walk with them as they continue to surge forward economically, socially, diplomatically and culturally. As we have heard, we would not be the first to do so. The Iraqi government itself and the Supreme Court have already acknowledged acts of genocide against the Kurdish people. In 2005, The Hague established that chemical bombing in Kurdistan constituted genocide. Unfortunately, this was later reverted to war crimes in a subsequent appeal. In 2008, the research institute Swiss Peace recognised genocide. And in 2013, we must do the same. And we must use our membership of the EU and the UN to pursue this to its fullest extent. The government responded to my honourable friend from Stratford-upon-Avon's petition, recognition of genocide against the Kurds in Iraq, by saying, and I will quote, "It remains the government's view that it is not for governments to decide whether a genocide has been committed in this case, as this is a complex legal question. But where we have heard that other governments have recognised it, other courts have recognised it, and taking into account the definition of genocide, surely it is time for our government to revisit this and to rethink its position. This is a political issue that we should take a lead on. A widely cited index by Monocle placed Britain as the most powerful nation on earth in terms of soft power. We have a reputation for diplomatic excellence, for being a champion of human rights and a beacon for democracy. We owe it to our Kurdish partners to use this power to promote justice for all Kurdish people wherever they are in the world." There is also a practical element to this. As I learned on my visit to Kurdistan, recognition of genocide would assist the Kurdistan government in their mission to uncover the 270 reported mass graves and the perhaps many more unreported mass graves, where between 500,000 and 1 million missing people were buried. As we have heard, the Kurdistan Mass Graves Commission have said there is another Iraq under Iraq, and that is a very chilling statement and one that we have to stand by and to support. Recognising the genocide against the Kurds is becoming increasingly pressing, given the ongoing slaughter in Syria and the possible use of chemical weapons, and it is extremely pertinent time to be reflecting on this issue, given recently that this House commemorated Holocaust Memorial Day. This was a day not only to remember the Holocaust, but to remember subsequent genocides that have blighted the world, such as those in Cambodia, Bosnia, Rwanda and Darfur. And I would like to see Kurdistan counted among this list. The Holocaust Memorial Day Trust made it clear that remembering and acknowledging are acts of reconciliation. But how can we have reconciliation without recognition? Recognition is vital if we are to ensure that such barbaric crimes do not happen again. Yeah. One survivor looked back on his experiences in Halabja and said, "I screamed, but there was no one left to hear me." I think we owe it to all those who lost their lives and all those who bear the haunting memories to demonstrate that we are listening, that we have heard their cries for justice, and that we are going to respond. I therefore call upon the government to formally recognise the genocide against the Kurds and the people of Iraqi Kurdistan, and encourage them to use their good offices to encourage other nations, the EU and the UN, to do likewise. We must never forget what has happened, and we must do all we can to seek recognition for the people of Kurdistan.
Yeah.
David Anderson.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, can I just start by praising the honourable member, the modern-day bard from Stratford-upon-Avon, for successfully getting this debate, and for those wonderful people on the Backbench Business Committee for agreeing to have the debate today. Yeah. I also particularly want to pay tribute to our honourable friend from the Curran Valley, and also the member from Islington, for the work they did in this house. Three decades ago, when most of us who were in the room today weren't actually in this house, and when, to some extent, Iraq, what was happening in Iraq was in the background of what was going on in our lives, perhaps not so much for example, the member for Stratford because of his personal links. For most of us, we probably had a lot of other things to be occupied with, so it probably didn't get the attention it should have at that time. And perhaps we've been as involved and as active as we became 2 decades later, perhaps things may have been different, and particularly the attitude that we had towards the Iraqi government at that time might have been different. We may well not be talking about this thing today. I want to focus on the impact of what happened back then on real human beings. My interaction with Iraq really started in 2003 as the president of Unison, the biggest trade union in Britain at that time, and a member of the General Council of the TUC. Like most people in the Labour movement, I was completely and utterly opposed to the invasion of Iraq. I believed that the reasons for going into Iraq were not justified. I believe that the argument about WND had not been proven, that we were going in far too early, that Hans Blick was doing good work on the ground despite the obvious obstacles that had been put in his place, and nothing should have been done until at least that work had been completed. I still remain convinced today that the reason why the leader of my party, the leader of our government at that time, decided to go into Iraq along with the Americans was A, because he passionately believed that Saddam should be got rid of and that he wanted to keep very, very good relations with the Americans. I believe the Americans went in for different reasons. I believe they wanted to get rid of Saddam. They did, to a certain extent, want to gain control of the oil wealth in that part of the world. But even more important to the Republican Party in America, they wanted to ensure that George Bush got re-elected 18 months after the invasion. That is why, no matter what we'd have done, I remain convinced that the Americans would have gone into Iraq around about the time they did, because that fitted perfectly into the run-up for their election, which was some 18 months ahead. After the war, or the conflict that was war, the military action had finished, my role in my tenure at that time was to say, what do we do now? And one of the benefits of what had happened during the removal of Saddam was the emergence once again of a trade union movement in Iraq, a trade union movement that pre-Saddam's reign had been one of the most active and was seen as being one of the largest from Europe to Australia. Very, very active trade union movement that had been suppressed. And we took a decision as a trade union that we would do our bit to try and help people who had not done real trade unions for at least 4 decades to try and find their way in the world again. We set up a training scheme for trade union stewards, and we brought people from Iraq, which was basically Kurdistan because the rest of Iraq know to get out. We brought them to London, set up a training scheme for a small group of trade unions who would go back and train the trainers. Certainly.
Is my honourable friend also aware of the work that's been done by the NASUWT, very similar with the Iraqi trade unions, doing exactly the same thing, training trainers so that they too can develop the Iraqi teachers' union across the whole of Iraq?
I thank my honourable friend very much. I'm very aware of that indeed. One of the people who I'm going to refer to later was a member of the delegation that I led in 2006, who was the treasurer of the NASUWT at the time, a woman who also chaired the TUC task group on Iraq. That training programme was so successful, we ended up expanding it. And instead of having to bring people out of Kurdistan to London, we brought them out of Kurdistan to Amman in Jordan, much, much easier in terms of numbers. And I was really proud when we were finally able to establish a trade union trainee school in Erbil in Kurdistan in early 2006. And as a newly elected MP, I was delighted to receive the backing of the trade union movement to take the delegation out to Erbil in early 2006. 8 of us went, including the members from the NASUWT, the journalist union, Unison, local councillors, and people who have been active in supporting the Iraqi cause for many, many years. We went out there just to see what we could do to develop trade unions on the ground. And I was immensely struck straight away by the attitude of the trade unions that we met. These, to me, were comrades. The fact that they were from another part of the world was irrelevant to me. They were my friends, standing up for working people, trying to develop their skills so they could look after people properly. The first thing they said to me was, we need your help to get your government to start investing in this country. Because if they don't invest, we won't have work. If we don't have work, we don't have a trade union movement. A very, very simple equation. And we said, well, what can we do? What practically can we do? So they arranged for us to go and meet with our government ministers, the Minister of Labour, the Minister of Equality, the Minister of Health, and also the Minister responsible for the Anfal and the genocide. And that really was the first time that I'd been exposed to what happened. But the other thing that they said very, very clearly was, we thank you as a nation for what you did for us in 1991, and we thank you even more what you did for us as a nation in 2003 by liberating us. Now, for me, that was a shock. That was a slap in the face. I saw what happened in 2003 as an invasion. But it's all right for me sitting back here in the comfort of Bladen and saying it's really, really wrong to do that. It wasn't me that was being wiped off the face of the earth. It wasn't my parents who were being buried alive. It wasn't my village that was being flattened. It wasn't my way of life, my community, that was being devastated and destroyed. But it was these people. And I had to listen to them. It still didn't change my mind about the fact of why we went in was wrong. But what did come very, very clear to me, and has ever since, is why on earth didn't we do it 20 years before? Because if we'd done it 20 years before, this disgraceful thing would not have happened. But what were we doing 20 years before? Unfortunately, we were doing the bidding of Saddam Hussein. We were, to an extent, sitting on our hands, supporting the Americans yet again, while they and the rest of the world powers were sitting happily back, watching the Iranians and the Iraqis wipe a million of their own citizens out, using them as pawns. And if, as a byproduct, we saw people like the Marshallers being wiped off the face of the earth, like the attack on the Kurds happening, well, we just had to ignore that. That was a price worth paying so that Saddam was able to keep the Ayatollah and his acolytes under control. Was it worth it in terms of the international situation? Well, other people, history will decide. For me, looking back and seeing what I do now, I think it was absolutely the wrong thing to do. We weren't just sitting back innocently, though, as was said before by the member of Cullen Valley and also by the member of Islington. We were actively engaged. We were selling this regime arms. We were selling both regimes arms, to be honest. And it was the wrong thing to do. And while it may well have been very, very grandiose in the big scheme of things, it did nothing to help the people on the ground. Since that first visit to Kurdistan, I've been back again to Kurdistan, also to Baghdad, and in both occasions I've been hugely impressed by the people, the real generosity, the warmth of these people. It's typical of the people of the Middle East, but it's even more noticeable, I think, in Kurdistan. It's like everyone from the North East, everybody knows where in the world you're from, the North East. Always much warmer people, more generous, more humorous, more given. Everybody understands that, wherever they're from. But I will mention about, and it's been mentioned earlier by colleagues who've been across to Kurdistan, about the Red House, the torture chamber in Soleimani. Anybody who goes there can't feel what we struck for it. The first thing that struck me was, this is a huge building. It's a huge building on the main street of one of the biggest cities in that part of the world. There was no attempt to hide from the public what was going on in that place. And not only was there not an attempt, there was everything that was done was documented. People had before mentioned the Holocaust. They used exactly the same methods of the Holocaust, and that everybody was documented, everything was in triplicate. And it was just, you know, they saw this as being a normal thing to do, to wipe people off the face of the earth because you didn't care for them and you wanted to supplement them with your own people. Absolutely unbelievable. But one of the things that always sticks in my mind was, in 2006, as we were walking out of the Red House, there's a reception. And in the reception, there was five Kurdish guards sitting around just watching the TV. And on the TV, live, was a trial of Saddam Hussein. And to me, it was like, this is real history in the making. And it was like, you know, again, for them, this was life-changing for them. This was going to give them a chance to get their lives back. And as I said before, for people like me who didn't want us to go into that country, it was a huge, huge wake-up call about what can we do. And I think what we can do, certainly, is promote what we do today.
Well, I'm very grateful to him for giving way. He's absolutely right about the way the regime documented it, and on the DVDs that I referred to earlier, the thing that is most shocking is that the footage of what happened is the footage from the regime. So you are seeing people being shot. One of the most horrific things to me, and why it's more horrific than seeing somebody killed, I'm not quite sure, but is to see a man who is being held by several other men and having his wrist beaten until literally it is broken, and you see the person come along at the end and move his hand, and there's literally no connection. And it is just brutal. And there really is no excuse for us not to recognise it, because this evidence is there.
My own friends, there was never any attempt to pretend it wasn't happening. It was just the hope that the rest of the world would not care that it wasn't happening, or would just turn a blind eye, which is exactly what we all did as an international community. That's why today we have the chance to at least make amends for that in a small way. And that's why it's so important we do that. As well as visiting the Red House, I visited some of the villages out in the country, the northeast of the country, where people saw the way of life absolutely terminated. Not only did they take the men away from the homes and kill them, and in many ways, what my honourable friend said about what really shocked her, what shocked me as much as anything else, was the fact that a lot of these people were actually buried alive. They didn't even give people the justice of putting a bullet in the brain. They put them in trenches and covered them with bulldozers. That's how little feeling they had, how much contempt they had for these people. I discussed with families and the friends there to spare. I visited effectively what had become a concentration camp in the capital of Bill, where only young men and women were in these, and there were the young men and women who were being taken away from the agricultural area, which had been the breadbasket of Iraq, and now is devastated. And all these young people want to do is we want to go back home. The sad thing is, if they go back home, they won't know where to start to get the farms up and running again, because they've lost the contact with the farming industry, because the fathers were taken away and killed 20 years ago, and they've got nobody to tell them how to do it. We visited a place in the north of the country, and the elder from that village was apart from the fact he thought I was Gordon Brown, I don't know where he got that idea from. I don't know who was the more myth, me or Gordon. But this elder was explaining to me how passionately in 1991 he welcomed Linda Chalker, who got across as the overseas aid minister at the time, and built some temporary accommodation. And he remembered that 17 years later, and the pride he felt in my country for helping their country in that way made me feel really proud to be a member of this house, but also quite frustrated because we hadn't just kept up the work that we should have in supporting those people. We, quite clear, as I said before, that the big question set was, why didn't you help us earlier? And we know why, and I've went through it before, and I just hope that today's debate will remind us of why we should have done that. I want to just read out, Mr Deputy Speaker, a letter I've received from a very close friend of mine, Hango Khan, who is a trade union leader in Kurdistan, someone I'm very proud to call a comrade, somebody who asked me if I'd go and visit his mother and father. I said, certainly I will. I didn't realise it was 3.5 hours ride up in the mountains. It was well worth doing. And when you meet these people, so proud of what their son had done. And he sent this letter on behalf of his trade union executive at the when we began this campaign with the colleagues across the House. And thanks us for starting the campaign. And he goes on to say, the Kurdish United Workers are well aware of all the genocide which has been committed against Kurdish people in Iraq. Moreover, our members are made aware that the Kurdish people are still suffering significantly from the genocide effects on all their life aspects. We really appreciate your invaluable efforts alongside other different people and groups to ask the government urgently not to ignore all these crimes against humanity which have been committed against us, our nation, for decades, and to recognise it as genocide. In fact, having recognised this genocide against our nation, this should enter into the history forever and should be a proud step in the view of human beings, especially the Kurdish people. There is no doubt this act will be considered as a voice of the conscience of humanity. Finally, let us thank you very much in the name of our burned country, the pure pink blood of our genocide martyrs, buried alive innocent women and children, burned and drowned thousands of Kurdish by chemical gas. As we are part of human beings, we do hope that all of us and the governments and nations are aware of recognising any genocide which is committed anywhere in the world. And that was sent from the Kurdistan United Workers Union in September of last year. In the last 50 years, Mr Deputy Speaker, millions of lives have been wasted around Iraq. Billions of pounds have been wasted. And trillions of words have been wasted. I just hope the words of Hangar Khan aren't wasted. We should listen to him today. We will make a huge statement as a House, because I'm convinced this House will pass this motion. But to be honest, while that's important, it is nowhere near as important as our government seeing the support we're trying to do. And I want to close by asking both front benches to really, really think about what's been said in this debate today. I know there are legal issues. I know that people will say, well, we'd like to do this, but we can't. But we've also seen this week the the rebirth of that horrible phrase, weasel words. I've got nothing but respect for the two members on either front bench here today. I know that both of them are committed to the work they are doing. But unless we do something other than just say well done to the people in this House debate, unless we get a commitment that our government is going to lead this campaign, and we should lead this campaign, then, to be honest with you, this debate, by and large, has been quite meaningless. That's no disrespect to the intent of the people who have led the debate, all the people who have supported us in bringing this together. We need real action. And we need also to bear in our minds that 25 years ago, if we'd had real action, we could have stopped this. We as a nation could have stopped this. We chose not to. Let's not repeat that mistake today.
Jeremy Corbyn.
Deputy Speaker, and I thank my friend the Member for Bladen and others for their speeches they've just made and the contribution they've made to this whole issue. And I particularly thank the Member for Stratford for his speech, and as he quite rightly points out, the first Kurdish member of the British Parliament, and he and I indeed have shared platforms at Kurdish events, and no doubt we will again in the future. And I think the way he's put the case for recognition of what was a genocide of the Kurdish people in Iraq in 1988 is a very good one, and I actually support what he's absolutely support what he's saying and the points he's making. And next month will be Nevroz, the Kurdish New Year, and that will be celebrated across a wide range of communities in this country and of course all over the region, and one hopes that we'll be able to draw attention to what happened in Iraq in 1988. As the member for Cunham Valleys pointed out, she and I were both members of this House at that time, and together we frequently raised the whole issue of it and also within the British media. And whilst lack of knowledge of much of the public is understandable because of the way in which the media were failing to report things, I think we have to be quite honest about it, that it took an awful long time for most of the media and most of the political establishment in this country to cotton on to what was really happening towards the Kurdish people in Iraq. And quite honestly, a lot of British government policy was blindsided because of their obsession with supporting Iraq against Iran in the dreadful Iran-Iraq war, and the considerable economic interests that Britain had in Iraq at that time, but not least on oil exploration and exploitation and other issues. And so I think we have to have a sense of deep self-criticism on that whole process, and not having that sense of self-criticism does us no favours at all. And when the news did finally come out about the use of gas, and as the member for Sheffield pointed out, the way in which the villages were bombed first to break the glass to make sure the gas had the maximum effect, all that, it was absolutely evil piece of work that was done, in which a large number of wonderful, brilliant people lost their lives. And in remembering a genocide, we have to work out how it happened, how it came about, and how one stops it happening again. And I want to say a few words, if I may, in general about Kurdistan and Kurdish people and how we move on from there, because there is a sort of complicated narrative in world history of equating nations with nation states, ethnic communities and languages with nation states, and it doesn't always work. And at the end of the First World War, which was a seminal point in the whole region, as a germane to the whole history of the region, the Kurdish people had been part of the Ottoman, had a degree of recognition within the Ottoman, and operated as a Kurdish identity and a Kurdish language. And they took at face value Woodrow Wilson's 14 points, as indeed many, many other people in the region, including Palestinian people and many others, took at face value Woodrow Wilson's 14 points and assumed that they would all get nationhood as a result of it. The high point of Kurdish recognition was a little bit of a sandwich between the Treaty of Sèvres and the Treaty of Lausanne. Between that, there was a recognition of a Kurdish state. Modern Turkey was established, the Western interests were more interested in a buffer against the Soviet Union, more interested in the mandates that France and Britain achieved further south, and the Kurdish people and their wishes were obliterated. And Britain did not have clean hands in this. We took part in the establishment of modern Iraq, and indeed the first aerial bombardment of people using chemical weapons was done by Britain in northern Iraq in 1922 against Kurdish people. And so there's a whole history of obliteration of the Kurdish people, their language, their culture and their identity. So what Saddam was doing was the ultimate in oppression of a nation or a people, but the treatment of Kurdish people in other countries within the region to this very day needs to be examined. The treatment of Kurdish people in Iran, the treatment of Kurdish people in Syria, and the treatment of Kurdish people in Turkey. I have a very substantial Kurdish population in my constituency, mainly, but not all, emanating from Turkey, and indeed I've visited most parts of Kurdistan over the years, and it is very sad to report that we still do not have full recognition of Kurdish people within modern Turkey. We still do not have mother tongue teaching in all Turkish schools, or indeed any Turkish schools for that matter, except those that Turkish is the first language. And I think it's incumbent on us, if Turkey wants to be a partner either in the European Union or in anything else, to put a great deal of pressure on them to say, you have to give greater recognition, linguistic rights, cultural rights, and all the other things to the Kurdish people in Turkey. And indeed, it doesn't particularly help when the mayor of a major city like Diyarbakir is put on trial for producing information in the Kurdish language, which is the normal language for that part of the country. And so the breakup of the Ottoman led to that situation, and there's been this passion ever since for recognition by the Kurdish people. Now, to a huge extent, that has been achieved with the Kurdish Autonomous Region of Iraq. It's not totally correct to call it independent, because in legal terms internationally it's not an independent recognised state, but in reality it is recognised as a representative place of the Kurdish people. And that, and what is more than welcome over the last few weeks has been that under a great deal of pressure following hunger strikes and of course the dreadful assassination that took place in Paris a few weeks ago, or assassinations rather, the Turkish government has now openly admitted it has to talk to Öcalan as a very recognisable leader of Kurdish people within Turkey. And there's a growing sense of unity between Kurdish people within the nation states of all of those countries that there has to be some degree of coming together. Does this mean there's going to be a country called Kurdistan that encompasses parts of those countries in the future? I don't know, and indeed none of the Kurdish national movements any longer, so far as I'm aware, call for an independent Kurdistan out with national borders. They're all calling for recognition within national borders, so far as I'm aware, and that is something that I think we have to understand, welcome and recognise. If you oppress people, deny them their language, deny them their cultural rights, drive them into the ground in the way in which minorities have been treated prior to genocides all over the world, including Native Americans, including Jewish people, including many, many others all over the world in the past 150 years, then you end up with the acceptance of the ultimate oppression, which is what happened in that genocide in 1988. And so I support the resolution that's before us today. Now, many have drawn attention to the achievements as they are in modern Iraq with the Kurdish region, and I recognise those. Indeed, I visited that region after the Gulf War in 1991. I opposed, along with a number of colleagues, including my friend the Manfred Bladen, the Iraq War in 2003, not because I was in any sense ever an apologist of any sort for Saddam Hussein or what he did. I just did not believe the motives for the war were the right ones. I believed they were more to do with American military power and mineral resources than anything else. And I thought an awful lot of people were going to die and an awful lot of money was going to be spent as a result. And so whilst people are never going to agree completely on that, I think we are all agreed that the Kurdish people have had an abominable record of their treatment by successive governments in Iraq, and one hopes that the Kurdish Autonomous Region will be recognised universally, and that will be a place where Kurdish people can live. When we talk of genocides and holocausts, obviously the recognition of the Holocaust against Jewish people in Europe in the 1930s and 1940s is paramount in everyone's thoughts, and indeed attending Holocaust Memorial Day is a very important thing, and young people understanding what the Holocaust was about is very important. It's also important for them to understand that there have been other genocides around the world. I mean, there isn't time to go through all of them or define them all, but it is an important thing to understand. And the European treatment of Native Americans on the colonisation of North America, both in the 16th century onwards, particularly later on, was to all intents and purposes a genocide against those people. Then one looks at others such as Cambodia, Rwanda, which was absolutely abominable and appalling, and then perhaps closer to the area we're talking about now, and this is one that does excite an awful lot of criticism, when any of us place an EDM down here recognising the Armenian massacre of 1915 and associating that with the same principles of what happened to the Kurdish people, one finds a great deal of criticism from people who frankly ought to know better in Turkey that we have no right to draw attention to that. So I think it is important that we understand that history has been abominable in the treatment of people as a result of racist attitudes and racist approaches which end up condoning the most vile abuses of human rights. I'm happy to give way to the member.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Honourable Member for Islington North. You mentioned Holocaust Day, and personally, having been slightly involved in what I consider to be a Holocaust in Bosnia, whenever I speak at Holocaust Day, or whenever I attend any ceremony, I'm not just thinking of the Jewish Holocaust. I certainly consider Armenia, and I certainly can think of the Kurds, and I can think of the Cambodians as well. So I think I totally agree with you. When we talk Holocaust, Holocaust is more than just one particular nation.
I thank the member for that intervention, and I think we're actually in agreement on that, at that point here. In conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I'm proud to represent a significant number of Kurdish people in my constituency. I'm proud of the contribution that they make wherever they've come from or if they're born in this country. And when we celebrate Nevroz in Finsbury Park in a month's time, that will be, as ever, a joyous celebration, hopefully this time with the greatest possible unity between Kurdish people from every part of the Kurdish area. If we recognise a genocide, that's a big step. It's recognising something defined in law as the attempt to obliterate a people because of their identity, their race, their ethnicity. In doing that, we recognise something awful that happened. In doing that, we have to examine ourselves and what we did or didn't do at the time as a country, or indeed as a series of countries. And it does help the next generation to understand that if you don't forget, you're in a position to try and influence the future and protect minorities wherever they be all over the world, because tragically the genocides that we've already mentioned in this debate were not the first, and I hope they're the last, but unfortunately I'm not sure they will be the last. It's recognition of people, their rights, their identity, their culture, their traditions and their understanding that brings about a safer and more secure world. It's not necessarily wars, bombs and invasions. It's much more about understanding and recognition of people and their rights and sharing resources, not stealing resources.
Ian Lucas.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. This has been an absolutely outstanding debate here this afternoon, and everyone who is present here today knows that the cause of recognition of the genocide in Kurdistan has very noble, very well-informed and very eloquent torchbearers, and they have brought to the House today speeches of great force, great eloquence, great sincerity that have made the case very eloquently indeed. And everyone who has spoken in this debate should be very proud of the contribution that they have made. And can I start by saying to my very good friend from Bladen that I have listened very, very closely to this debate. I've learned so much in this debate today, and I will consider extremely carefully everything that has been said today. I'm conscious, I think, that I'm the first speaker in this debate who has not visited Kurdistan. And I should perhaps, therefore, firstly apologise for that fact. And I do hope that this is something that will be remedied very shortly. Because what I have become aware of in the role that I have on the front bench is the great warmth that exists between the people of Kurdistan and of the United Kingdom. And I have had many conversations and discussions about Kurdistan and heard very many accounts of the importance of that relationship. And what is striking about the strength of the relationship is the fact that, as we've heard today, there are aspects of the relationship that bring shame on Britain. Because in the past, governments of all colours have done things of which we should not be proud, and the people of Kurdistan, in their current dealings and in their current warmth, show forgiveness to us and respect that does them great credit. And for that, I think we thank them very, very much indeed. I must start, I think, by congratulating the Honourable Member for Stratford-on-Avon, who, of course, one of the great advantages of this House and people coming from different backgrounds is that they bring their own experiences, their own cultures, their own knowledge to subjects such as this. And he spoke very eloquently indeed, and with a power and with a persuasion which was compelling. And, of course, his personal connections are something very special, and he should be commended for persuading the Backbench Business Committee, who we should also thank for allowing this debate to take place. Because I think that after today, when we've had time to reflect, I think that one thing that is common amongst all of us is that this is a matter that must be taken forward and that must be considered and reflected upon. And he has, by bringing it to the House today, taken a big step forward in dealing with this issue and carrying it ahead. We also heard an excellent speech from the Honourable Member for Sheffield Healey, who brought her experience of visits and the links between Sheffield and Kurdistan, which are building, I think, the whole time. And also she referred to films that she has seen of the terrible acts that took place, and which have been referred to many times in these debates. And I remember myself, I think very clearly, a Newsnight report many, many years ago about the Halabja attacks that when I saw it, shocked me profoundly at the time. It was long before, I think it was in the late 1980s, shortly after the attacks themselves had taken place. And I was moved profoundly by those films, because they showed a ferocity and inhumanity and a inability to treat people with respect, which was quite extraordinary and was difficult to believe could happen. So I'd be very interested myself in seeing the films that my honourable friend has referred to, because I think the words that we've tried to struggle to find today to explain how dreadful the events in Kurdistan were over that period cannot reflect the acts that did take place. We then heard from the Honourable Member from Harlow, who speaks with great passion on these issues and brought his personal experience to bear upon the facts, and his Jewish background, I think, adds a particular aspect to this debate, and that is, of course, hugely relevant to what we are discussing today. And I was very conscious when I attended an excellent Holocaust Memorial Day service just across the road of the constant emphasis that the Jewish community places upon the fact that the Holocaust isn't just about the Jewish community. On that day, earlier this year, a Rwandan survivor explained the effect of the Rwandan genocide upon her, and she spoke as eloquently as Holocaust survivors did on that day. So it's very important that we see this as part of a broader picture. We then heard from the Honourable Member for Cynon Valley, who I think has an extremely long and extremely impressive record and consistent record on human rights issues, and in particular in connection with Iraq. And I think I first got to know her in the period after I came to the House between 2001 and 2003, when she was involved in the organisation Indict, which she referred to. And I remember that not many people were involved in the campaign at that time, which became much more evident after 2003. But she was dogged, determined, and absolutely committed to the cause of bringing people to justice. And she pursued that from the time that I met her in 2001, and she's pursuing it today. She's a very busy woman, so unfortunately she's not here at the moment, but she is someone with a very long and very proud record. And she, of course, and the consistency that she has shown on this issue, right through from the 80s until now, well, from 1977, she tells us today, is something that does her great credit, and I'm proud to record her as a friend and as someone who has taught me a huge amount about this issue. We then heard from the Honourable Member from Basildon, who has an advantage over me in that he's visited Kurdistan, and the compelling case that he made too. And I think it's very important, actually, that the public out there are aware that we are considering these issues and that we are visiting these places, because these are hugely important issues for all of us as parliamentarians. And I think it does great credit to all of the members who are here today that they are here today and that we are discussing this important issue. And then we heard from the Honourable Member from Bladen, who I understand in this House like no one else does.
Careful.
And I remember a conversation we had outside the chamber about this very issue when he described the complicated situation that he has on the issue of Iraq, and in fact the contradiction that he sees in perhaps his views on the Iraq war in 2003 and the contacts that he's had subsequently. And this isn't a straightforward issue. This is a difficult issue, and our job is about difficult issues. And the debate that we're having today is, again, on a difficult issue. And as the Honourable Member for Islington North said, another man who has a long and proud record campaigning on these issues, it's a big step for this House and any government to say that individual sets of incidents and events constitute a genocide. And it is a step that has been taken, we know, by some other parliaments, and they've been referred to today. And we know that those steps have not been taken by particular governments of those from the same countries as those parliaments represent, because the issue of whether a set of incidents can be described as a genocide is something that has a legal status. It's established under the 1948 Genocide Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide, as defined as mass killings or other acts intended to destroy a particular group of people. The phrase is, of course, or the word is used colloquially, but the definition of the term under international law is quite specific. And genocide requires both a material element of the acts of the killing and a mental element, the intention to destroy a particular group. That's certainly a good way.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Honourable Gentleman very much. I've been involved in a genocide. What I want to say, just to add to your point, is that if you are that poor, frightened, absolutely terrified individual facing the agony of being killed, you don't give a damn whether it's called a genocide, a crime against humanity. You are just frightened beyond your wits. And I'm sure the Honourable Gentleman will agree with me. And I'm just thinking these definitions have always worried me, because I used to think like that when I was in Bosnia in 92, 93.
The Honourable Gentleman speaks with a passion and eloquence from his own experience. And we all respect that experience and of course, recognise the humanity of what he says. And we need to consider, when dealing with these issues, how best we can together take forward the hope that what we can do today will ensure that these incidents do not happen again, and something on the scale of a genocide does not happen again. That is what we all need to try to achieve. And what we should do today is reflect upon what has been said and consider how best we can take forward the issue of preventing genocide ever occurring again. Once has been quite sufficient. We never want to see it again. I'll give way.
I'm very grateful to my honourable friend for giving way, and I understand the issues he's raising and the legal issues, and I'm sure the Minister will come to that at the moment. But we have a situation where governments often now look to give apologies for things which happened many, many years ago, and I have concerns that those aren't really necessarily terribly relevant, because it was somebody else who did that. Here we're in a situation where a government could recognise genocide. It's not something this government or any previous government has particularly done, but maybe on the back of this debate, now is the time for opposition parties and government parties to come together and say, shouldn't we look at whether this government and governments in the future should have a process to recognise genocide, because it is important.
It's certainly important, and I think that what is important is that these matters are dealt with collectively, because we are an international community and we have international institutions. And I think that when we have an international situation such as the one we are discussing today, the appropriate approach is to work through international justice bodies to recognise when particular circumstances amount to such as a genocide. And if they did amount to such a genocide, then we need to use the institutions which we have in order to establish when those facts exist and the implications of those facts in law. Because the legal implications of recognising any set of events as a genocide, not just the events that we're considering today, are very considerable. It creates a particular crime under international law, and that imposes obligations upon states to prevent and to punish in connection with those particular sets of circumstances. So, when an incident has happened in the past, as we're discussing today, then that means that if they're defined as genocide, the issue arises whether in fact there's a retrospective element to that, and whether the current application of a description to a set of events as a genocide then enables actions to be taken retrospectively in respect of those acts. So I think that one of the issues that we need to consider is the retrospectivity of the issues, and I think it would be helpful if the Minister could clarify whether it's his understanding that a statement would create a retrospective effect, and, for example, present actions could be taken against anyone held responsible in connection with previous actions that took place back in the 1980s. We've heard today of the progress that Kurdistan has made, the very considerable progress it's made, which is building on the relationship that exists between this country and the Kurdistan region of Iraq. And I think that the debate today will, I hope, add to that relationship. There is a very strong group of members of this House who've spoken eloquently today, who have great respect for Kurdistan and great respect for the Kurdish people. We, I think, need to work together to reflect upon the discussions that we've had today, to look at what other countries are doing concerning this issue of genocide in the Kurdish region, and seeing what actions are being taken by other countries, whether they be parliaments or whether they be governments, and what is the appropriate forum for the taking forward of consideration of this issue. I'll give way.
In line with what I remember from Sheffield Hill, he said about practical things about the opposition can do. Will he today commit our party to entering discussions with the Kurdistan regional government based in this country about whether they can help us to get evidence that may well help to develop a legal argument that the international community can then come alongside and say, yes, we think it is, or if it isn't, these are the reasons why?
I'll be pleased to meet with representatives of the Kurdish regional government to discuss the issues that we've been discussing today and to see what barriers are in the way of this matter being taken forward. And I would also be pleased to speak to the Honourable Gentleman, the Minister, to discuss this matter further, to see whether we can explore further common ground on an issue that is considered by a number of backbenchers from both the parties that we represent is extremely important, and who have today made a very eloquent and compelling case on the issue. We cannot reach conclusions today, but we've heard compelling cases, and this is a matter which is a start, not an end. I think we need to continue to discuss these matters, to discuss them in detail, and to reflect on the best way that we can take this forward. It is best taken forward collectively, both within this country and also internationally. We've seen actions by other parliaments in the past. I think we need to reflect upon those, and we then need to see what steps we can best take to deal with this appalling set of circumstances that the people of Kurdistan suffered in the 1980s, and see how we can work together to make sure that the pain, the suffering, the grief that they have is not shared by any other group of people again in the future.
Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I don't know about anybody else, I don't know about other honourable members, and certainly those watching anywhere around the world these days, but my goodness, this has been a tough debate to listen to. It has been, as the Honourable Gentleman has said, an exceptional debate in terms of its quality, the knowledge with which colleagues speak, the compassion with which they speak, the honesty with which they've confronted the issue. And I'm very pleased on behalf of the government to be able to respond. Can I start, as always, by thanking the Honourable Member for Stratford-on-Avon for securing the debate and for the backbench committee in agreeing to have it. The Honourable Gentleman will have to get used over time to being congratulated on a regular basis. He speaks, I found it a powerful and compelling narrative. But those of us that have heard him speak before knows that there's nothing unusual in relation to that. He's already made a name in the House, and he's done nothing but further cement it today. But he spoke exceptionally well, and we are impressed. The pain with which he described his own background, the circumstances of being a refugee, graphically illustrated in a way that none of us with a more forensic sense about these things could possibly repeat or be able to share. It should constantly, however, bring a measure of pride to this country as we occasionally debate who comes across our borders, to remember the reputation that we've had for providing sanctuary to people who have fled a conflict and pain unimaginable to most of our constituents. And I think my honourable friend put that extremely well. I will mention most of the other colleagues have spoken during the course of the remarks and seek to weave it in. I would pay, however, again, special mention to the honourable, Right Honourable Lady, the Member for Kinnan Valley, and also the Honourable Gentleman Member for Islington North, who was in the House, as I was, at the times of which we spoke, but took part in a way in which I did not, and speak as well as they did and as effectively as they did about things going on that we, alas, knew about far too little. But both, again, spoke very graphically. The Honourable Lady, with the details of what happened, which, painful though they are to hear, occasionally need to be said, to be reminded that behind all the figures, the 182,000, there were individual circumstances to be described. A few years ago, I went with colleagues to Rwanda and to Murumbai, the genocide memorial there, where some 60,000 people were corralled and then killed over a period of a few days. And the experience of seeing the places where these mass attacks have taken place, the mass graves which the Right Honourable Lady spoke, they leave an indelible impression, and you cannot help but be changed by what you hear. So I commend colleagues for the way in which they've spoken, and I hope many people get the opportunity to read the debate and consider very carefully what we have said. As many members have said, our ties with the Iraqi Kurds are significant. Historically, United Kingdom and Iraqi Kurdish ties were cemented in 1991 with the United Kingdom's strong support, led by our then Prime Minister John Major, for protecting the Kurdish people by enforcing no-fly zones. Since that time, successive UK governments have highlighted the need to support the rights of the Kurdish people as well as the other minorities in Iraq. And I was in the region a couple of years ago when they were looking forward to John Major being able to come along for the commemoration of 20 years after the no-fly zone and the relief of Kuwait, and there was no doubt in what esteem Sir John was held, and it was a pleasure as a friend to listen to, and there are other friends here from the other place who will know full well exactly how he is felt, and there are others at that time who also deserve great credit for the way in which they spoke out on behalf of those who were being persecuted. The Honourable Gentleman, the Member for Bladen, in what I thought was a really interesting speech, confronted very honestly the problems occasionally thrown up by the twin difficulties of foreign policy in hindsight, and confronted the issues there. I think he's right to express the fact that sometimes we don't know everything and we make decisions as best we can at the time. I'm not sure if, looking back, the Honourable Gentleman made the point about should we have done more earlier. I do remember the time of the 1991 Gulf War and the arguments then. Should the forces have pressed on to Baghdad? That was the argument. It's easily forgotten that there was no mandate for that. There was a coalition to free Kuwait. And had a decision then been taken to press on to Baghdad and remove Saddam Hussein, which subsequently perhaps became clear that it might have been the thing to do. I can feel the resistance now that there would have been at the time for what would have seen an intervention too far. Interventions in hindsight are so much easier than interventions in terms of current affairs. And the Honourable Gentleman and I know that full well in relation to some of the issues with which we're dealing with at the moment. But in the same spirit, looking back and listening to what the Honourable Gentleman from Islington North said about arms fairs in Baghdad around about the time and the rebuffs from ministers, were my colleagues right at that time? Probably not. Probably not. And again, with the wisdom of hindsight, what we might have done with knowledge that we had at that time. So in the same spirit, I confront the difficulties of hindsight and foreign policy and just say that from this dispatch box. As members, a number of members have made clear The Iraqi regime under Saddam Hussein systematically persecuted and oppressed ethnic and religious groups over many years. No group suffered more than Iraq's Kurds. Saddam Hussein's regime carried out a number of atrocities against the Kurds over a quarter of a century. As many as 100,000 Kurds were killed in the Anfal attacks and many more displaced. This year, as we reach its 25th anniversary in March, we will remember in particular the attack on Halabja in 1988, when Iraqi planes bombarded the town with chemical weapons, causing the deaths of between 3,500 and 5,000 people in ways described by colleagues during the course of the debate. I will go on to say more about the appalling crimes committed against Iraq's Kurds and the need to ensure that no people should suffer a similar fate. However, in line with one or two of colleagues who've mentioned, I would like to say a few words about the Kurdistan Regional Government and the region in Iraq and our relationship with it, because I think it is important in remembering the past also to recognise what has happened since and put that on record. I was able to see the fruits of this relationship firsthand during my recent visit to Erbil, the second time I've been able to visit the region. And my friend is absolutely right. You must get there as soon as you can. It's a very good place to visit. I'm quite sure that your thoughts of going there will have been listened to in all the right quarters. And I'm sure you will look forward to going and seeing the new consulate general, or at least, sorry, the new consulate that is due to be built, and at least the site now has been identified for it, and you will be very welcome. And the Honourable Gentleman just needs to let me know, and we'll see what can be done. Can I also pay tribute to the Honourable Lady, who has piped up at this moment, for her indefatigable work in relation to democracy building in so many different places, and not least in relation to that region and her work in terms of that. The efforts now being placed, perhaps after a recognition of so much that has gone wrong, in the building blocks of democracy, the institutions that have to be built up. As the Honourable Lady said, and she knows from her work from the Westminster Foundation for Democracy, an election isn't democracy per se. You've got to make sure you have another election, and that they're free and fair, and that the institutions support elections, and that power changes. And sooner or later, people realise power is not invested just in individuals, but in institutions. And in some of the places where we're all collectively working, there's a bit of a way to go. But the efforts that have been made in the Kurdistan region of Iraq make very clear that there is fertile ground on which that work is being done. And I pay tribute to the Honourable Lady and her friends. During my recent visit, I had the pleasure of meeting both President Barzani and Deputy Prime Minister Imad Ahmed. I toured the British designed airport with Interior Minister Karim Sinjari and met several other cabinet ministers. With Planning Minister Dr. Ali Sindhi, I also attended the signing of a contract to expand a major National School of International, a National School of Government International from London, to expand that capacity building programme with the KRG. In October, my right honourable friend, the Foreign Secretary, announced that our Consulate General in Erbil should be maintained on a permanent footing. The KRG have generously donated land where a new UK Consulate General will be built, and the Head of Foreign Relations, Farah Bakir, presented me with a letter confirming the donation during my visit. That visit was rounded off with a tour of the 7,000-year-old citadel, Erbil's premier tourist location, which claims to be the longest continuously occupied place in the world. I was pleased to note the involvement of British archaeologists in the ongoing programme to restore the citadel, another example of the UK's long-standing ties with the Kurdistan region. And I would say to any colleagues who's looking for tips to how to be re-elected, simply go round Erbil with the governor. We paid a visit to the market, and the response to this gentleman was absolutely terrific. And I wanted a piece of that to take back to Biggleswade to help me in my in the next election campaign. But it was really a generous, a genuine, spontaneous outburst of affection for the gentleman as we toured the market. And I thought, this chap knows what he's doing. Visits are not all one way. Members of the KRG frequently visit the United Kingdom. Earlier this month, President Barzani made his first official visit to Belfast and had discussions with, amongst others, Northern Ireland's First and Deputy First Minister, as well as the Speaker of the Assembly. And so, even as we rightly remember those who lost their lives 25 years ago, we should also think about how far the KRG has come. Those returning to Erbil years later see real changes and are struck by its relative security and burgeoning economy. And my honourable friend, the member for Harlow, who again made yet another impressive contribution to this House, was able to reflect on how those fleeing persecution as Christians from other parts of Iraq were able to find a home in Erbil, in the Kurdish region. And it's a proper distinction to make. As we reflect on Christian flight across the Middle East, and not just that, the persecution of almost any other religious minority other than that of the majority in the locality at the time, we realise how important it is that people firstly have their rights recognised and protected, but there are those prepared to take them in. And across the region again, tragically this evening, there are many families camped out in the homes of others seeking refuge from the conflicts that rage about them. But to recognise the KRG's position and the Kurdish region's generosity in relation to this is not inappropriate at present. Amongst EU countries, the United Kingdom has the largest number of companies registered and operating within the Kurdistan region, while 61 British delegates, representing 39 companies, participated in the Erbil trade fair in October last year. And my honourable friend, the member for South Basildon and Thurrock, made particular reference to the importance of that trade relationship, and he's absolutely right to do so, with opportunities for many. And while the oil and gas sector understandably accounts for significant UK investment in the Kurdish region, it's not the only sector where our companies are actively engaged. We know that more can be done, which is why we're strengthening our commercial team in Erbil to help British companies do business in the region.
Can I just gently remind the Minister, it is actually about genocide, and I know he does want to talk about other areas, but we do want to try and keep within the scope of the debate. Minister.
I will. I will happily do so and return to that. I thought it just might be helpful just to set the region in context before returning to some of the tougher parts that were described. If I may take just one further moment just to relate this to Iraq in general, if I may, not to forget Kurdistan, the Kurdish region of Iraq as part of Iraq. To take a moment to remember, as the 10th anniversary of the start of the Iraq War approaches, those who died during that war, including 178 British service personnel, and of course many Iraqis and other nationals. For that sacrifice too has contributed to the relative peace of the region now, and our ability therefore to look back and to evaluate the circumstances of the time. And the anniversary is also a time to reflect on Iraq's present and its future. And during my visit, a recent visit to Iraq, I was able to see both the challenges and opportunities that it faces. You know, fundamental political issues remain unresolved there. Human rights standards are low, and public services, infrastructure and employment opportunities are inadequate. But Iraq does have the chance to be one of the success stories of the coming decade as a stable democracy. And the patient being work done on democracy building throughout the rest of Iraq, the engagements we have with ministers there, the efforts they are making to confront some of the very difficult political challenges between them. And I met a range of ministers, from my good friend Foreign Minister Zabari, who chaired with me a ministerial trade council. All sorts of efforts being made to improve the future for all in Iraq. So as we remember the past and consider the challenges of the present, I hope we can look forward to a future for Iraq that's more stable, democratic and prosperous, and that the UK can play a role in making that reality. But to return to the motion of today's debate, I'll set out the government's position on whether we should recognise the terrible events of the Anfal campaign as an act of genocide. I'm aware of my honourable friend's commendable support for the victims of Saddam's dreadful campaign against the Kurds, and for his call for Saddam's crimes to be recognised as genocide by the international community. And I've heard today, as we all have, that this is a view shared by many other honourable members, and many more who could not be present today, and many members of the public who've signed a petition he submitted to Parliament on this. My honourable friend and other members of the House will be aware of the government's position on the principle of genocide recognition, and indeed he stated it, as indeed did the honourable gentleman, the member for Wrexham. I'm greatly sympathetic to the motion of this debate. The government does not in any way oppose it, and I've no doubt that Parliament will respond to the views expressed by my honourable friend and the terms of the motion. It is currently the government's view, as we stated in responding to my honourable friend's e-petition on the issue that it's not for governments to decide whether a genocide has been committed in this case, as it is a complex legal position. And the honourable gentleman for Wrexham was quite right. It has implications both today and for yesterday. Where an international judicial body finds a crime to have been a genocide will often play an important part in whether the United Kingdom will recognise one as such. Well, whether or not the term genocide is applicable in this case, it's clear that appalling atrocities were perpetrated against the Iraqi Kurds under Saddam Hussein, whose final conviction by the Iraq tribunal was for his crimes against humanity. I will. I've more to say on this issue, but if she wants to interrupt now, she may.
The Minister for giving way, and I genuinely call him an honourable friend in this and many other circumstances. I understand the issues that he's raising, and he will have heard the point that I made to my honourable friend on the front bench. But can I say to him that in taking this issue seriously, will he commit himself and the Foreign and Commonwealth Office to campaign on this issue, to raise it with other people and to look at this issue in international bodies, because he knows just how strongly this matter is felt by honourable members here today.
Minister. Let me get a little further. So many suffered as a result of Saddam's criminal activities, and we should remember all the victims of the regime. I reiterated this view in my foreword to the programme for the KRG's recent conference on the issue. It's also a reminder that any use of chemical or biological weapons is abhorrent, and that responsible countries consider their ongoing production, stockpiling or use to be completely unacceptable. It is our moral duty to join the international community in their efforts to prevent future atrocities, and we will continue to call it every opportunity for all countries to respect minority rights and for the full implementation of the Chemical Weapons Conventions. Of course, these issues form part of our dialogue with the Kurdistan Regional Government, in particular with the Minister for Martyrs and Anfal Affairs. In May last year, our then Consul General spoke at a ceremony alongside the Minister to mark the reburial of 730 Kurds killed in 1988 by Saddam's forces as part of the Anfal campaign. More recently, our Consul General in Erbil discussed Saddam's Anfal campaign with the Minister for Martyrs and Anfal Affairs in November. He will represent the UK at future ceremonies and express the UK and remembrance of these tragic events. And I had the opportunity to speak to the Minister myself when I was there recently. The government's position is therefore clear, but it's not necessarily comfortable or sufficient. And to the horror, no doubt, of officials, I have listened very carefully to the nature of the debate. And in line with the Honourable Gentleman for Wrexham, I'm sure our brief said more or less exactly the same. Be very careful. There are implications. I make no bones about this. This is not a casual decision to be made at a dispatch box listening to a debate, understandably, with an emotional undertone and with the horrors spelt out. And I'm not going to do that. But I have listened very carefully. And I don't think I would be respecting the mood of the House and the way in which this has been put if I was to simply say, look, this is our position, which you all know very well, and that's where we are. And I don't think that's what the Honourable Gentleman said either. I think we both know the implications, but I think we both also recognise that we would like to go a bit further. I've listened very carefully and with whatever compassion I may possess to the case that's been made out. I don't doubt that the Foreign Secretary will also read the debate as well with exactly the same sense. And I'm sure the government will find the vote of Parliament helpful when further representations made, as they will be. The Honourable Gentleman resisted an easy hit, which would have been simply to respond to the motion and say this must be done. But conscious of the obligations on his bench, he couldn't go that far, nor can I. But I do take forward both his sense that if there is not an easy way to bring this forward to international judicial tribunals, and there may not be at the moment, what more might we be able to do? Taking into account the other things that they said, the Honourable Gentleman Member for Islington North made it very clear that there are others who have similar things to be considered, so there are a lot of implications. But listening to the case, understanding the case, gives you a sense that, you know, perhaps there is more collectively that we ought to be able to do to recognise just the sheer horror and severity of what was done very clearly, targeted on a group of people just because of who they were. And I think if I can, I would accept the Honourable Gentleman's offer. And I think we might think collectively about how the United Kingdom might be able to take this forward. But there's no change in our policy for now, and we're correct in doing that. But the things that have been mentioned are going to be raised again. So we may have to think, certainly talk to other parliaments and governments about how this has been done and be fully aware of the concerns. But I think that's a reasonable way for us to respond. One or two things in particular were raised, and if I have just a couple of minutes to finish off, perhaps I can do that. We do think, as far as other parliaments are concerned, again, it's important that they've done so, but that's a matter of principle for them, and understandably that can't be internationally binding. But I think we will try and investigate what is behind that. We've not been able to recognise, as one of my honourable friends raised, the decision of the Iraqi Criminal Tribunal as genocide. The government considers legal judgments by appropriate courts in deciding whether or not such atrocity should be designated as an act of genocide. The judgment of the Iraqi Criminal Tribunal was that of a national tribunal. My honourable friend, the member for both my honourable friends, the members for Stratford-on-Avon and Harlow, made reference to the Dutch court. Now, my understanding, we've looked at this quite carefully. We're happy to look again at the Dutch Court of Appeal's decision in the Von Anrat case. But as we understand it, while the court considered the question, it concluded there was not a genocide. It's our understanding that Mr. Van Anrat was convicted for complicity in war crimes. But in a sense, that's a that's a detail. It's the point is made, and we need to look at how these matters might be dealt with. Can I say in conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, the following? Such a debate as this is particularly painful, as we all know that even as we speak, someone somewhere in the world is being killed, not because of anything they may have done, but simply because of who they are, their clan, their faith, their ethnicity, above all, simply their otherness. The ability of people to stamp some grotesque caricature of power or superiority on others through violence and torture is an unsated appetite, made still worse, all too often, by the ability of others ever to do enough or even anything to prevent it. We may differ on our view of how atrocities such as those visited upon Iraq's Kurds come to be designated. And I made clear, I share all the honourable members' views, that Iraq's Kurds suffered a terrible and prolonged injustice under the previous regime. Accordingly, as we approach the 25th anniversary of the appalling atrocities perpetrated against the Kurds at Halabja and elsewhere, it's important we take a minute to reflect on the suffering cause, to reflect also with some shame on that phrase, never again, but find somewhere in our remembrance and recognition of the past a more meaningful way to confront the horrors that form the raw material of senseless killing throughout the world on an all too regular basis.
Nadhim Zahawi.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I feel like a bit of an imposter standing here today, because so many colleagues, both in this chamber and the other place, have done so much more for the Kurdish cause, not least the Right Honourable Member for Cunan Valley, who I recall as a student at University College London, attending one of the Qadri protests on behalf of the Kurdish people and the Iraqi people. And that was a time that aroused my passion to do something about what was taking place in Iraq and in Kurdistan. We heard from the member for Islington North a very powerful speech. Indeed, it is a real privilege to be a member of this chamber when such speeches are delivered and to listen to them live. He spoke eloquently about the plight of the Kurdish people all over the region, and especially in Turkey. All I would say to him is that I attended the AK Party Congress in Turkey as a representative of my own party, and what was extraordinary was that Prime Minister Erdogan actually invited the president of the Kurdish regional government, Masoud Barzani, to address the Congress in Kurdish, live on Turkish television. That was an extraordinary moment, but there is more to do indeed in that country to bring peace to the Kurdish people of that country, and I'm pleased to hear that the talks with Abdullah Öcalan are proceeding with pace. We heard from my honourable colleague, who very kindly also sat on that backbench business committee and obviously declared an interest because of his passion for the Kurdish people, about his work with the trade union movement. I know that both he and my honourable friend Fahalo are passionate about trade unionism and the work they've done. Indeed, we visited the trade union, the Kurdish United Workers Union, together on one of our trips to Kurdistan, and you can see how the union movement is flourishing in Erbil. We also heard from the honourable member for South Basildon and East Thurrock about the psyche of the Kurdish people, a proud nation, not a nation of victims, and about the diaspora around the world watching us here today having this debate, and of course about the Kurdish regional government pressing the Baghdad government to join the International Criminal Court to ensure that such atrocities never happen again. Now, of course, my partner in crime and my co-chairman of the all-party group is the member for Sheffield Heeley, and I have to tell you that she and I led a delegation of over 90 British businesses to Kurdistan last year, and although I had to be recalled by my whips to vote on a European vote in this chamber, she stood in and proudly opened that fair with the President of Kurdistan and the then Prime Minister Barham Saleh. She spoke powerfully and eloquently today about the video of the Kurdish and the Iraqi people selling their consciences to Saddam Hussein because they lived in fear, and of the children who live with cancer because of no fault of their own. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I talked in my opening remarks about the town of Halabja. Here in the gallery today are survivors of those crimes, men, women and children that lived through the terrible attacks on Halabja. We owe it to them to declare these events as what they truly were, a genocide. But one thing I will never forget, Mr. Deputy Speaker, was my visit with the Lord Archer in 1991 to the Barzani town of Qushtepe. When we entered that town, we were met by 8,000 women, wives, mothers, sisters and grandmothers. All wore black. All were in mourning at the disappearance of every single male in that town. Today, the Foreign Secretary is in Rome, attempting to save the Syrian people from the indiscriminate killing of another Ba'athist regime, that of Bashar al-Assad. But what a message it would send to the world if, while our nation seeks to protect those still suffering, we are also able to recognise those who already have suffered. This Parliament is coming towards its 750th birthday. What a message, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it would send if the mother of all parliaments were to recognise and to endorse this motion. That is why I'm here today, to call on this motion to be passed. Thank you very much. Yeah.
The question is, as on the order paper, as many of that opinion say, aye.
Aye.
The contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.